collided with a small vehicle head on.
Where's the pain?
He's hit the car and then been thrown through the air 15 metres and landed on the ground.
Is he breathing?
Brandon, you with us?
Big breaths, Brandon, big breaths. Brandon.
Would you rescue me when I'm by myself? When I need your love, if I need your help, would you rescue me? Would you rescue me? But I start to wonder if I'm slipping under. Oh, would you rescue me? Would you give my
love? Very worried for you, my friend.
The bone's been smashed to bits.
Whoa!
He's actually stopped breathing.
Yeah.
Without intervention, he's quite likely to die.
Da-da.
As emergency doctor Jonathan Papson begins his shift, he gets news of a trauma patient who's being rushed into emergency by ambulance.
Well, motorbikes are always a big problem, just period. Problem, motorbike problem.
We'll do a little team brief.
Let's do it.
The patient is 45-year-old Braden.
Do you have a pelvic binder on?
Yeah.
Who borrowed a friend's motorbike to go to the bank when the accident happened. Paramedics have given the retail worker ketamine, a powerful painkiller.
How you going there, mate?
It takes.
Yeah, it's some medicine for the pain.
Yeah.
Looks like you got a broken ankle.
Yeah.
Nice to meet you, Braden. I'm Liz.
We always worry about motorbike crashes because there's just such a potential for many different kinds of injuries.
All right, on count of three, one, two, three.
You can break your pelvis, you can break your arms, you can break your legs, you can break the whole lot.
One,
nice and
two,
gentle,
three.
Holding the leg. Yep.
So Brandon was the rider of a motorbike, travelling at approximately 80 kilometres an hour when he collided with a small vehicle head-on.
Just a big breath in for me.
Braden was found approximately 15 metres past the vehicle.
Is your tummy sore at all, mate?
No. He's got significant swelling and pain to the lower left ankle. Potential fracture, dislocation.
Lung slide's normal, not tender. Abdo's not tender, I'll just do the fast.
Where's the pain?
It's killing me.
He's hit the car and then been thrown through the air 15 metres and landed on the ground. We'll do a chest x-ray. He's got a sore ankle and he's got a sore foot, so we definitely need an x-ray there.
Chest x-ray, please.
Yep.
Braden's been riding motorbikes since he was 13, but today's decision to jump on his mate's bike could have life-changing consequences.
We've just got an x-ray coming through. We can see so much on a chest x-ray and trauma, that's why we still do it. But that looks good.
Hello, how are you going?
I'm good, how are you?
Airway's good. Is that ketamine?
Yeah, fine.
Ketamine's it's not just a painkiller, it's an anaesthetic. They become dissociated from reality and they can start to babble and talk and hallucinate and say things they wouldn't ordinarily say. That's just normal for this kind of medicine.
I'm just going to check your tummy with the ulcers. Are you okay? What's going on? What's going on? You're going to be all right, okay? Some of the medicine we gave you might make you feel a bit odd, like you're having an out-of-body experience. The fast is looking negative.
The ultrasound actually looks okay, and his lungs look okay, and his abdomen looks okay, so that's great.
I know that we're tackling you from all angles, and I'm really sorry. We'll get you some pain in a minute, okay? It's all right.
With Braden in such acute pain, they need to quickly see what they're dealing with.
Cut it.
Emergency registrar Dr. Andrew Wallace is famous in the ED for his footwear, or should that be infamous?
Well, yeah, I always get a lot of grief for my bright white Crocs, but they are, you know, they wipe straight off and, you know, every little stain's maybe just a memory of trauma and patients gone by. know. I think they're all right.
But wait, that's not all.
I do a lot of paediatric stuff, so I've always got, like, novelty socks. Just have a nice selection of Australian bird socks that didn't start as a collection but is slowly becoming one somehow. So I should find out what brand it is and just buy them in bulk.
After flying for over an hour from country Victoria, Dr. Andrew's next patient is arriving by air ambulance. The patient is 65-year-old David.
Quick trip down to the ED, David.
Who's gone over the handlebars of his bicycle while riding down Mount Hotham.
How's the pain at the moment, mate?
It's a bit sore.
David had travelled 500 kilometres from Canberra to join a cycling trip with his mates.
Is he a trauma alert from a...
Dr. Andrew is leading the trauma team.
This guy's look sore. Cycling accidents can be terrible, especially if you're going over the handlebars. You know, we see dreadful injuries from especially downhill fast speed.
Hold nice and still. We'll do all the hard work, okay? Cut. One, two, three.
The team waste no time starting their assessment, looking for injuries that could threaten David's life.
So David is a 65-year-old man. At 1:15 this afternoon, he's riding down Mount Hotham and his bike has hit a depression in the road.
My name's Natalie, I'm the trauma doctor.
He's been thrown forwards over the handlebars, landing heavily, mostly on the right-hand side of his upper right chest. He's not been able to walk since the event. He's got a right side pneumothorax and he's also got a lot of tenderness to his right hip.
Is he on a pelvic binder?
He has got a pelvic binder on.
Thank you.
Who lives with me?
David's partner of 30 years, Kathy, is at home in Canberra waiting for news.
Premier survey.
The main things that I'm worried about is right chest, right pelvis, slash right hip.
Right, so let's get a chest, pelvic x-ray, I'll do a fast scan. Just concerned that this right pneumothorax would worsen, worried about pelvic fracture.
David's taken a big fall to his right-hand side. When someone's complaining about pelvic pain, we put on a pelvic binder. The idea of this is to stop any blood loss that's been going on.
Any signs of a head injury?
There is a nasal abrasion.
Yep.
Other than that, no scalp
fracture. How is the helmet? Is it compromised? Yeah, OK. The helmet's compromised.
David's helmet's cracked. It's in a really bad shape. It's a good thing that the helmet's taken the big brunt of the injury and it's done its job in protecting his head.
Hey, David, my name's Andrew, one of the ED doctors. As promised, we're just going to do this ultrasound scan, all right?
As Dr. Andrew begins looking for internal injuries...
I'm just above here. I'm setting up for the x-ray.
OK.
David's chest is also x-rayed.
All ready for x-ray when everyone else is?
Yep, ready.
X-ray recess one. David, do you remember the handlebars sticking in when you went over? Anyway?
Against your
tummy or anything?
That's cool.
Okay.
So, EVAS positive for right pneumothorax. Negative otherwise.
The ultrasound confirms what we thought. David's right lung's collapsed. A collapsed lung is incredibly painful. Every time you're trying to breathe in, the body will be sending really painful signals to the brain.
Pulse x-ray is ready. X-ray, recess one.
Yep.
So we do have a pelvic fracture.
Yep.
Emergency doctor Natalie Guinea breaks the news to David about the extent of his injuries.
You've broken your pelvis on the right side. It probably explains why it's so sore.
You can lose 1 to 2 litres of blood into your pelvis and patients can die.
We ordered CT scans.
I don't know whether he did or not.
David's got a collapsed lung on the right side and he's got a broken pelvis. These are big injuries. There could be even bigger ones lying in wait, so we've got to take him for a CT to make sure. Cut it.
Yeah,
look at that. Oh, fuck! Ow!
45-year-old motorbike rider Braden has been in a serious collision with a car.
So that's sort of like a scuffing, skidding kind of injury, isn't it? Rather than an open fracture.
Having been thrown 15 metres through the air onto the ground, it's crucial Dr. Jonathan assesses the damage Braden's done to his ankle.
Take it out.
Well done.
Looks broken.
Ankle, please. Ankle x-ray.
We might as well just put a back slam on that now and then we'll go to CT.
In this situation, we'll put what's called a back slab on. It's just a temporary plaster that'll hold his foot in place. So that means that when we shuffle him across onto the CT table, it won't hurt because a fracture hurts every single time you move it.
So where's the fracture?
The x-ray of Braden's ankle is not what Dr. Jonathan was expecting.
Maybe it's the foot.
His ankle looks okay, but he's got signs in his foot that make me worry that he does have a fracture there.
Is it more the front of your foot that hurts?
Oh, in that,
yeah. Yeah, so he's got a foot fracture, hasn't he? Is that so?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, that's so. What about this?
Yeah,
so he's got midfoot fracture. Yeah, okay. Well, let's get a backstab one anyway. And to do that, I think we should give him some ketamine.
All right, I'm just going to hold your head because we're going to put a different collar on, okay?
Worried about spinal injuries, emergency nurse Liz Wheeler puts Braden in a hard collar.
You're doing really well, mate. Right, this can't be easy for you.
This collar is going to protect Braden's spine. We need to keep him immobilised. This is going to prevent any further damage to his spine.
All right. Do you think you can swallow for us? No issues?
Yeah.
Lovely.
20 of ketamine given.
Having given Braden more painkillers, Dr. Jonathan and the team can now stabilise his leg.
You ready? Let's do it. Just going to pop the little thing on your ankle there.
Oh!
You're okay. You're okay. You're okay. That's the way. Yep, I've got that. Right. Good. Good, good, good. Yep. Okay, I'll wrap it up.
It's not unexpected that someone with these kinds of injuries will need quite a lot of sedation.
I'll go grab some tape.
Yeah. Not making much noise there. Is it
alright?
He's okay? Yeah. Not making any noise anymore.
Take some deep breaths. Hey mate, you still with us? Brandon? It's got a bit of nystagmus eyes going on. Brandon?
Hey.
You with us?
Braden has become unresponsive.
Big breaths, Braden, big breaths.
Braided.
Take some deep breaths. Hey, mate, you still with us?
Braden's still not responding.
Is he breathing?
Do you know if the paramedics contacted your family?
My sister-in-law, I spoke to her.
Okay.
65-year-old cyclist David has a punctured lung and broken pelvis after coming off his bicycle while riding down Mount Hotham.
Spoken to my wife.
Okay. We'll make sure they're updated with everything as well as we keep you going, all right?
David urgently needs a CT scan to check for any other internal injuries.
Log roll and binder. And remove the old one once you've got R1 on.
Dr. Andrew also wants to replace the temporary binder that's holding David's pelvis together with a sturdier one.
So actually, we'll probably put the pelvic binder under from your sides. Log roll, feel down, slide it across, two bands and then remove it.
This is a dangerous procedure. The team have to keep David's pelvis very tightly bound as they remove the old binder and put the new one on.
Do I need to do anything?
This way, yeah?
No. The most you can do is just put your arms very gently across your chest, but that's it.
Allowing one of the major pelvic vessels to bleed due to a lax pelvic binder or a misplaced one could cause massive injuries to the patient. They could lose a huge amount of blood in their pelvis and possibly death if undetected.
We'll go on three. One, two, three.
It is quite a difficult injury to deal with. And on top of that, there's quite a lot of pain associated with it.
One, two, three. Well, that probably won't pull through because it's wrapped around.
How are we gonna get a second binder? I've never done it where we do a binder over a binder.
Yeah, sure.
We try and loosen the old one for a small amount of time because we want to continue to compress the pelvis as much as possible.
What we're gonna do is once we undo this one, We'll just try and slide it upwards and put the other one down.
The one that's laying here.
Yeah, okay, so undo it.
Do you want to cut the buckle?
Yeah.
There's a problem.
Where's the scissors?
The orange binder buckle is preventing the old binder strap from being pulled out from under David's body.
Try and cut through. It's tight.
Yeah. Throw shears, okay.
Come on. Hey, good job.
Sorry.
That's pretty tight. And we should be able to get the rest down.
We're not safe.
There we go.
Here we are. Okay, that should be last amount of moving about for a while.
CT?
CT, right.
With David's pelvis secured, he can now be safely moved for his CT scan.
One, two, three.
Very bland.
How are you feeling?
My left leg is a bit sore.
He's got a couple of broken ribs and he's got a pelvic fracture.
Looking through David's scans, it's confirmed he's got at least two breaks in the pelvic ring. We confirmed that he's got multiple rib fractures, the lungs collapsed, and there is also blood in the chest. I think it'll be difficult for David to avoid an operation. David's got an extended road to recovery. I think he's definitely not going to be able to be riding a bike for weeks, probably into the months.
My wife's back in Canberra. I don't know, there's going to be many warnings about be careful on the bike.
Hey, mate, you still with us?
You
with us?
Is he breathing?
45-year-old motorbike rider Braden is unresponsive after being hit by a car.
Take some deep breaths. Just having a bit of the effect of the ketamine.
To combat his excruciating pain from a suspected broken foot, he's been given ketamine, a powerful painkiller and sedative.
Take some deep breaths.
Any breaths, Liz?
Can you take a deep breath for me, Brandon?
All right, ketamine, yep.
In these trauma cases, we don't have a lot of opportunity to fully assess how someone's going to react to the drugs we give them. So we have to make the best guess.
So maybe just watch the situation here.
But I also need to be aware that he may become unconscious from my strong anaesthetic drugs that I'm giving him. And he may stop breathing for a period of time.
Take some deep breaths. Take some deep breaths, Brayden. Brandon, can you hear me? He's responding now.
He's breathing by himself. I don't need to help him anymore. And he's alert and orientated, so that's pretty good.
Now that's more comfortable. He probably doesn't have any reason to feel any pain.
Do you know where you are? Where are you? Yeah, and what's the day today?
The day now.
Or the day.
Beautiful day.
Pardon?
Beautiful day.
It's a beautiful day.
With Braden now breathing, their focus returns to his injured foot.
Did anyone check the pulse after we put the plaster on?
If you have a fracture and we can't feel a pulse, that makes us worry that the artery's been injured.
How'd you go? Pulse or not?
I couldn't get down far enough without moving it.
This looks like a pretty straightforward broken ankle, but if we can't find a pulse, that's a whole different thing. He's in a whole world of trouble, because no pulse means no circulation. No circulation could mean no foot.
How'd you go? Pulse or not?
Emergency doctor Jonathan is worried that the blood vessels in 45-year-old Braden's leg have been severely damaged after he crashed his motorbike.
Couldn't get down far enough without moving it.
If they have, the team won't be able to feel a pulse in his foot, and he could need an emergency operation.
I guess we have got it. Yep, beautiful.
He's got a pulse, That means we've got a little bit more time to work out what's going on, to further characterise exactly what kind of fracture he has and what's the best management for it.
I'm going to take you around to CT, OK?
If you're going that fast and you're riding a motorbike and you crash, you're probably going to break something. Looks like it's his foot or his ankle. I'm hoping that's all it is. The CT is going to be really useful.
Brendan, have you ever had a CT scan before?
Just breathe, take deep breaths in.
Brayden's quick decision to jump on his mate's motorbike to go to the bank may have been a costly one.
So this is Brayden's foot. Ooh. Ah, well, that's weird. I'm looking at a 3D picture, and I wondered whether he'd actually dislocated some of the bones, but it's just the way they're overlapped.
This looked to be a really nasty accident. Turns out doesn't have many injuries at all. He may have just sprained his ankle. Nasty sprain can be really painful.
He's in enough pain for it to be broken, and it looks like it's broken, so it should be broken. So it's pretty amazing if he's only got a sore ankle and a bit of an abrasion.
Remarkably, Brayden has no significant injuries after colliding with a car and being thrown through the air. He'll spend the next couple of days in hospital under observation before being sent home.
I am happy that it's not all busted and all out of place. Very, very happy for the guy.
Emergency doctor Lisa Walker has been part of the ED team for 7 years. And today, she's keeping some personal news close to her chest.
Can I steal you away and talk to
all
you
right,
about something?
Run away.
Do I want to?
Yes, you do. Come on.
I don't want to.
But her colleagues, doctors Jonathan Papson and Jasmine Poonian, have found out.
I need you to hand over a patient to me. It's very important. Come in here.
And they're not going to let her get away with it.
Happy birthday to our cheerful angel.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday!
Happy birthday.
I'll give you a mask
and a kiss. How's that?
And open the car.
Oh, God, it's 3D.
How does it feel to work your birthday?
I always work my birthday.
Yeah. How much of your birthday did you work before everyone found out it was your birthday?
2 hours.
That's pretty good. Normally I go the whole day.
And then one of the nurses found out on Facebook.
Yeah, see, I got a message on Facebook. That's how I knew.
Fixed it.
No.
Oh, beautiful.
That was beautiful.
But Dr. Lisa doesn't have time for cake.
Hey, Lisa, did we put him out as a trauma alert or anything? Yeah, cool.
She's just been alerted that an air ambulance is about to arrive with another severely injured motorbike rider on board.
Motorbikes are dangerous, so you're worried about a complete spectrum of blunt trauma.
The emergency department treats over 400 traumas from motorbike accidents every year.
I think this is a motorcycle, isn't it?
Yeah.
The patient is 27-year-old schoolteacher Callum, who was riding his motorbike in country Victoria. Callum only recently got his full motorbike licence, and it was his first time out on his new bike.
Straight ahead, guys.
Having been given ketamine by the paramedics, Callum is not feeling any pain.
Hello, sir. How are you? What's your name today?
Thank you, Callum.
The count of three. 1, 2, 3, please.
You can start doing your EFAS.
So this is Callum. Callum's 27-year-old male riding a motorbike up in the Yarra Ranges up near Warburton. Reported to be doing 70 kilometres an hour, failed to take a bend properly and come off the motorbike and been thrown approximately 10 metres. Wearing a helmet, full leathers. On assessment, clearing a fractured left scapula, got an obvious deformity to his left mid-shaft femur, so fracture there.
Have you got any allergies?
So he's had a pelvic splint applied, traction splint to his left leg and a collar.
Lisa, EFAS is negative.
Yeah. Do you see any chest trauma at all on him? No? No evidence of what might be a pneumothorax?
Important things, what do you teach?
I teach maths and physics.
Oh. What year?
Yeah, 10 to 12 at the moment.
Ah.
I'm just going through the process of deciding if I'm getting back on a motorbike or not.
No would be my recommendation.
Callum's parents, Linda and David, are at the hospital, waiting outside while the emergency team stabilise him.
Just the thought of your child coming off a bike and
the pain they might be in, where they are, lying on the side of a road, you know, all that. It was very emotional, the most biggest shock I've ever had in my entire life, hearing that.
Take a deep breath in for me, Callum. Hold your breath. Breathe normally.
It does look like he's busted his scapula.
Callum? Yes. Hi, I'm Liz. I'm one of the nurses.
Nice to meet you, Liz.
Nice to meet you too.
As the team prepare more x-rays, emergency nurse Liz Wheeler continues to assess Callum.
So the pain's a 5.
Yeah, in...
In the left. I'm just going to have a little look. So we've got a sort of a brace in situ, so that might be causing a little bit of friction. If not, it could be related to an injury.
We're going to x-ray the femur.
All right, just got to do another shot of your leg, OK?
All right, so we have an answer for why your leg hurts. You've broken your femur, which is the big bone in your thigh. Yeah. We're going to do a scan of the rest of you just to see if there's any other injuries.
A sting on my inner thigh.
That's yeah, right. That's also possibly the splint itself as well. It's because they can be quite uncomfortable.
Hey, I know you've been a hero, but do you reckon you might need some pain relief?
It's just.
How about we
my
just
thigh.
Do it because we're going to go to CT.
I think it's a good idea.
Panadol.
Yep.
It's getting really painful, the inner thigh on my skin.
All right. How's that pain treating you now?
Well, it's whatever it is on my thighs, like, distinct.
27-year-old schoolteacher Callum has broken his thigh bone and has a suspected fractured shoulder blade after a motorbike accident.
What's hurting?
That spot on my inner thigh.
Nurse Liz is growing increasingly concerned about the pain in Callum's thigh.
It looks like it's getting a little bit bigger.
Stinging in my inner thigh. It's
in, is it here that I'm touching?
No.
Or in here?
Down, like...
Here?
Yeah, about there.
It's where the swelling is. I'll just get the doctor to have another look. It could be compartment syndrome, which is where there's a lot of blood that's being lost into the tissue, which is causing a lot of compression on nerves and tissue. This can be very serious. Hey, I'm just checking in about recess 5. Mm. The left leg, and specifically where he's complaining about the pain, is quite a significant amount of swelling.
Yeah, it's because he's got a femur fracture, so we need to keep an eye on it.
If you diagnose a compartment syndrome, that's an indication to take a patient urgently to theatre to release the pressure.
You know, maybe this is a sign that maybe it's time to stop motorcycling and, you know, focus on my life and relationships.
Callum's accident is making him think about the important things in life. His new boyfriend.
I met someone recently who I've kind of fallen in love with, and I feel like, I don't know if I've been given a second chance to kind of be with them. I met him when I was over in Bali. Yeah, we've been talking, and, you know, he's devastated to hear that I'm in this situation. You can't be here, obviously, and it's difficult, but...
So what would you say it is on a scale of 1 to 10?
Maybe like a 7 or an 8.
Callum's left thigh pain is getting worse.
It's quite concerning that he does have quite severe pain. This could mean that he is progressing to having compartment syndrome. We need to get Callum to CT as soon as possible.
We have a 31-year-old male who was working on his ute and uses all of approximately 50 centimetres of car jack onto his left side. He's got bilateral neck pain in the left shoulder and left arm and left chest.
As Dr. Jonathan is partway through his shift, he gets news of a severely injured trauma patient being rushed into emergency.
That could be serious. Has it been allocated to someone?
Ever anyone's crushed under a car, it's usually a couple of tonnes or more of weight.
Just got a feeling that this is going to be worse than what we thought.
There are around 160 severe injuries each year caused by carjacks, including fractures, amputations and even death.
Obviously, he might have a broken pelvis too if he's crushed.
The patient is 31-year-old Sean, an ex-mechanic who was servicing a friend's ute when the accident occurred.
They'll have everyone ready for you.
The father of two is conscious but struggling to breathe after the jack gave way, pinning Sean on his left-hand side.
You're all right, mate?
paramedics have already given him morphine, a powerful painkiller.
Is this the gentleman who's been crushed under the jack?
Yep.
It's pretty sweaty. We'll get you in and sort you out, mate. Yeah. You saw, where are you saw? Across there, okay, yeah.
When we see a patient who's been involved in trauma and they're sweaty, that might be a sign of shock. He looks like he's in pain, he's worried. He's been in quite a frightening accident and he's pretty sore.
Ready, 1, 2, 3.
Well done, mate.
Sian could have any number of life-threatening injuries after being pinned under a 2-ton vehicle.
He's been trapped, he reckons, approximately 1 to 2 minutes, and he's been able to self-extricate.
Is that the pain that you're trying to breathe through? Yeah.
He's complaining of right and left-sided neck pain, left shoulder pain, with decreased movement in the left arm.
Did you hit your head? Yeah.
No, I didn't hit your head. But I got a really bad pain in my neck.
In your neck, okay.
It sounds like he's been able to push the car off himself. Pretty amazing. He must be a pretty strong guy. If he's got a injury to his neck, has he got some compression of his windpipe? And is that why the breathing's difficult?
And Sam, what do you got? What can you tell?
It's definitely lung sliding bilaterally. Struggling to get a good abdo view.
So no pneumothorax on ultrasound. Beautiful.
The ultrasound shows Sian doesn't have a punctured lung.
You've probably got some broken ribs, though. Does it hurt when you breathe? And this is not... Is this sore?
You've
probably broken some ribs, all right.
When your ribs are compressed, you can't breathe properly because your lung doesn't expand, and that's a life-threatening condition.
Yeah. Might just get x-ray then and we'll get the pictures.
Who do you live at home with?
My wife and
two kids. Sian's wife can't be with him as she's at home looking after their two young children.
He's a good husband and caring dad, and he's doing hard work. He's doing two jobs. I can't go with the hospital with Sian because I have two kids. I have to look them. And so he said, no need to come. Take care of our kids.
X-ray.
It's all right, isn't it? No subcutaneous emphysema. That looks pretty good, doesn't it?
It's pretty amazing we're not seeing any broken ribs because he's certainly behaving like he should have broken ribs. I mean, he's been crushed by a 2-ton SUV.
When he wheeled in, he said, my neck, he should have a collar.
Keeping Sian's neck stable is vital in case he has a neck or spinal injury.
You know, has he got a blunt carotid injury, right? That's the concern.
When people get a blow to the carotid artery, which is one of the main blood vessels in your neck, you can get blood clot forming in the lining of the wall of the artery. And one of the problems is a stroke. This can happen a day or two down the track.
I think we should CT him, shouldn't we? Let's do it. Make sure he hasn't got that, because we'll miss that otherwise. I think we should CT him, shouldn't we?
31-year-old pub manager Sian has been crushed after a jack gave way while he was servicing a friend's ute when the accident occurred.
Did something bang him in the neck?
Dr. Jonathan is worried he's damaged his carotid artery and needs to send him for a special type of CT scan.
So I think pan scan and then run some contrast up the carotid.
We need to do a special CT angiogram and run some contrast through the artery so we can get a better picture of what that artery looks like.
Do you want to call your wife?
Sian recently became a father for a second time. He wants to make sure his wife Shalani is updated and not worrying.
Is she sleeping already? Dad?
Is she giving milk to...
Oh, the baby. That's okay, we can try again.
Sian updates everything for me at the hospital. I'm confident with the doctors and nurses because they know what to do. We need him to come home.
I think it's your breath holding a little bit, but...
He's not taking any deep breaths.
Well, that's not
just
good.
3 litres on him.
Yeah, good. Yeah.
Sian is once again struggling to breathe normally.
When you breathe, does it hurt? Yeah? Yeah. Hard to breathe, isn't it? Okay, all right.
It's because of the pain.
Yeah, it'll be because of the pain. We'll just double check this ultrasound again.
Dr. Jonathan is taking no chances and wants to perform a second ultrasound.
Yeah, he's underventilating a bit, isn't he?
I'm handed his blood gas result. It tells me he's not breathing well enough and his CO2 level's up. And that's no surprise. But even if he doesn't have fractures that I can see on the x-ray, his soft tissues are so injured and hurt so much that he can't breathe properly. Sorry, mate. Sats are dodgy. He's not going to have a heart attack. No, the lung's definitely up, so that's good. No hemothorax.
So we repeat the ultrasound. Still looks good. He hasn't got a punctured lung, or at least not one that I can detect. And if I can't see it on ultrasound, it's going to be pretty small.
Just breathe as well as you can. We're going to give you lots of pain relief so you can take big breaths, and we're going to go to a CT and have a look. All right, let's go.
I am worried there's going to be something on that CT because he's in quite a bit of pain. He's uncomfortable.
You're now in the CT department and we're going to scan your head to your hips.
27-year-old motorbike rider Callum is having a CT scan after he came off the road and crashed at speed.
How are you feeling? You all right?
It's just the thigh.
Is the pain really, really bad? If the pain's unbearable?
It just, like, stings so much.
The scan will reveal if Callum's shoulder blade is broken and what's causing the pain in his left inner thigh.
We just want to make sure there's nothing else going on.
If this is compartment syndrome, he may need an emergency operation.
All right, let's go.
With Callum's tests completed, his parents, Linda and David, are now able to be with him.
Did it go in slow motion when you crashed it?
No.
In your head, is it deep in
there? It was just, hit the embankment and then I was bang on the ground.
So yeah, is that the motorbike career finished? Maybe.
Yes, yes.
Dr. Lisa can now see all of Callum's injuries.
It all looks pretty good.
There's major arteries and veins that run through the leg and you want to make sure that they haven't been damaged in the trauma, which they haven't been in Callum's case.
With the arteries in Callum's leg uninjured, it's good news he won't be needing an emergency operation.
He's not got a compartment syndrome. He's got a displaced femur fracture.
So good news. The only thing I can see on your scans is what we already knew, that you've broken that bone in your thigh. Mm-hmm. I can't see anything else. The bone guys are aware that you're here. We're going to get you into theatre to fix it tomorrow.
To prepare for Callum's operation...
Three, one, two, three.
He's moved onto a traction bed, which will help strengthen his broken thigh bone.
So we've got the CT6 splinter off, so we're just putting the stuff on for the traction.
What we know about femur fractures is if you can get them back to as close to their normal alignment, their pain's reduced, your bleeding's reduced, your swelling's reduced, and so you need to apply traction. We basically put a counterweight off the end of the bed that's attached to their foot, and that just pulls the leg out to its normal length.
All right, we'll just slowly let it down, OK?
Yeah. My magic looks a lot better.
Yeah, it's better.
Yeah.
As Callum leaves the ED, he seems undecided if he'll ever pull on the bike leathers again.
It'll definitely change the way I ride, if I ride at all ever again. We're going to take you for CT, OK?
Father of two, Sean, may have damaged his carotid artery after a 2-ton car fell on him while he was working underneath it.
I'll leave you in the very capable hands of our radiologists.
Sean has been injected with a special dye so the blood vessels in his neck can be picked up by the CT scanner because Dr. Jonathan thinks they may have been damaged.
This pulse scan's really quick, okay?
We're worried that he's got a blunt carotid injury. We have to have a look with the CT scan to see whether that artery is actually bruised, injured, dissected, so that we can prevent him having a stroke if it's injured.
The last thing we want to do is say, oh, it's all good, and miss that little injury and then have him come back with a big problem. This is the neck and the head, and this is the arteries inside. To have a look and see whether this one was bruised or cut or split. And you would see that there's a kink in the vessel and there's no kink. It looks okay.
Good news, we're not seeing a blunt carotid injury, which is great. It just means that his soft tissues, his muscles, his mass have actually taken the brunt of the impact.
We went ahead and we did a 3D reconstruction because I told them he's got rib fractures. Turns out, not really.
I'm expecting to find something causing the pain, but I'm not seeing it.
His ribs look okay, and his lungs look okay. So why the hell is he so sore, and why doesn't he breathe properly? What's going on? Did we scan the right patient? Always happy to not find an injury.
Relieved, Dr. Jonathan now breaks the good news to Sian.
How are we going?
Yeah.
So my quick look at your scan looks all right. Now that things have calmed down a bit, we'll just go a bit more precisely.
With Sian still in pain, Dr. Jonathan wants to be 100% sure he's in the clear.
So does this one hurt? Oh, that hurts, yeah, yeah. And does this one hurt? Yeah, that's sore too, yep, okay. And this one? A little bit, that's sore, yeah. And this one? It's all sore, isn't it? Yeah.
Even if he doesn't have broken ribs or a punctured lung, he could still run into trouble overnight just because it hurts too much to breathe, because they're not expanding their lungs properly and their lungs can clog up and the bottom parts of the lung can collapse.
So what I think we do is we keep you in hospital overnight. We give you some painkillers regularly so that you can breathe properly without it hurting. That's why we have the painkillers. So this is just for this situation, yeah. I'll come back, all right?
Thanks. 65-year-old cyclist David arrived at the Royal Melbourne after being thrown from his bicycle while riding down Mount Hotham.
So Eva's positive for a right pneumothorax.
Dr. Andrew found a punctured lung and a fractured pelvis.
These are big injuries.
David had surgery to fix his broken pelvis.
There was a couple of metal plates put in my hip, and then there was another pin put across the back to stabilise the pelvis.
He spent a month in hospital in Melbourne before he was able to go home to recover. And as for getting back in the saddle...
I'm a little bit nervous going on the road again. I've not gone beyond my street, really. You know, I'll be sticking to bike paths for a while.
I can keep an eye on you.
No, thank you.
Remember, be careful.
I shall.
But have fun.
Okay.
See ya.
See ya. Thanks.
It's like the old Dave. And that's a really good thing. He's feeling good. Feeling happy and happy Dave. Happy wife. Yay.
45-year-old Braden was in severe pain with a suspected broken foot after crashing a motorbike he'd borrowed from a mate.
We'll get you some pain in a minute, OK?
Remarkably, a CT scan revealed Braden didn't have any serious injuries.
It's pretty amazing if he's only got a sore ankle and a bit of an abrasion.
Knowing how lucky he's been, Braden's not planning on getting back on a motorbike anytime soon.
I'm staying off the bike now. No more bikes, mate. That's it. Getting too off and stuff.
2 days later, with just a sprained ankle, he was able to go home. School teacher Callum was airlifted to the Royal Melbourne after crashing his motorbike at speed. An X-ray revealed he'd broken his thigh bone, which left him wondering if motorbiking was really for him.
It'll definitely change the way I ride if I ride it all ever again.
After 3 days in hospital, Callum was transferred to a rehab clinic where there wasn't good news.
They found a blood clot in my leg. That was a bit of a setback mentally. I found that quite challenging.
It was nearly 3 months before he was able to return to the classroom.
When I got back, the students were very excited to see me.
As for getting back on two wheels, these days, Callum's preferring four.
Since the accident, I've gone and got my car driver's license. I needed a car, something with four walls and a roof around me to keep me safe. My parents have been very pleased that I no longer have a motorcycle, and yeah, they're much happier with me driving that. They can sleep at night now.
Everyone ready? One, two, three.
father of two, Sean, was struggling to breathe after a two-ton ute fell on him. Dr. Jonathan worried he'd damaged his carotid artery.
When he wheeled in, he said, "My neck." I think we should CT him, shouldn't we?
Scans revealed Sean had severe bruising, but no serious injury. After 2 days in hospital, he was able to go home.
Now I'm fully recovered, but I have a little painful around my neck. I think it will be all right.
He's still unsure how he wasn't seriously injured.
I don't remember at all how I get out from the car. So I just pushed out. Other than that, no idea. It's a miracle to me, actually. When I came out from the hospital, it was really overwhelming and my wife was crying. You came in one piece. It felt me really, really special.
For the time being, Sean won't be working under any cars.
But after the accident, I haven't done much cars because it still give me flashbacks of what has happened that day. So then it makes me a little bit frightened when I go underneath and put the jack up. Doctors and nurses in Royal Melbourne, I give my heart to them, actually. They've done a really amazing job. I don't know. I could have get that kind of service from anywhere in the world.